In half an hour, the creatures are in Australian river valleys.
And King George V becomes one of a long line of visitors from all over the world who come to the Birmingham suburb of Bourneville. Not to see the famous chocolate factory here, but the model community built up around it. The realisation of George Cadbury's dream of providing working men with decent homes filled with light, space and air. The population of Birmingham grew from 170,000 when Victoria came to the throne in 1837 to over 500,000 by the time of her death in 1901, adding housing to the other problems of the new city. While the corporation had provided some workers housing and had outlawed the worst types of jerry building in 1876, over 40,000 people still lived in back-to-backs hemmed in by dirt and smoky factories. It wasn't really anybody's fault. Anyway, it was far easier to point the finger of blame not at the industrialists who were reaping the profits, but at the city itself as a malignant living entity.
Like some jungle growth, Birmingham stretched and spread under the thrust and urge of the Industrial Revolution. Nobody had time to stop and think of the future. Nobody then could imagine the changes of the next 100 years. On our way to Bourneville, we pass thousands of homes of this sort, which were built during the Victorian age. Too many are still in use today. And then, 4.5 miles from the city centre, we pass through a tunnel and suddenly find ourselves in a setting like this. A garden village in the heart of a city. A green oasis in the wilderness of bricks and mortar we have just passed through.
There were others who'd shared George Cadbury's utopian vision that he'd realised at Bourneville. The owner of the company which made the first successful transatlantic cable held similar views.
Horsfall, he in a way had something of the Cadbury attitude. And you can see that by visiting hay mills today, because immediately by the entrance of the factory, there is a little tiny school. Horsfall himself was illiterate. He couldn't read or write, but he realised that literacy was important. So he built this little school. There's a plaque there telling you that James Horsfall built it. He built this little school for the children of his workers. And then a bit later on, he built a huge church, St Cyprian's Church, which is still there. And beyond the church, you have a long row of workers' cottages, which must, I think, have been built before the school, and they've recently been restored. So this little settlement, in some ways, is an early counterpart of Cadbury's Bourneville.
For George Cadbury's Bourneville had begun in much the same way as a factory-based housing development. When the new chocolate works was being built in the summer of 1879, Cadbury had 16 houses put up alongside for the families of the key workers, including the foreman. Cadbury was a Quaker and deeply concerned with the lot of those less fortunate than himself. His main motive from the start was humanitarian. Compared to the tunnel-back houses of nearby Selly Oak, these were exceptional homes. All were serviced by wide roads and had spacious back gardens where children could play in safety and where the tenants were encouraged, as indeed they still are, to plant trees and grow their own vegetables. The houses in Bourneville had their own kitchens, some with a sunken bath, and good-sized airy rooms. This at a time when in the inner city slums, families shared not only the same roof, but also the same standpipe and outside toilet. The success of these homes led in turn to the plan for the 140 acres of land Cadbury then bought for the houses, shops and schools of the Bourneville village estate and filmed to spread the gospel in 1919.
Thank you.
143 cottages were built on that first plot of land, and by 1900, when Cadbury set up the Bourneville Village Trust, the estate had grown to over 300 houses. The architect of those first houses was Alexander Harvey. He was asked to provide homes that were spacious, light and comfortable, yet at the same time imaginative in design and inexpensive to build. He designed a variety of houses which, though different on the outside, used the same basic internal layout. Under his control, the number of buildings on each plot of land was restricted to prevent houses overshadowing each other. Cadbury also stipulated that the streets should display a variety of styles in direct contrast to the dreary rows of bricks and mortar in nearby Selly Oak. None of the houses was to be less than a certain size, nor cost under £150 to build. This was intended to secure what Cadbury called a superior class of quiet and respectable tenant, the decent sort of chap that he and his brother encouraged among their own workforce. In the event, many of these thrifty workmen were soon cashing in on the demand for quality housing in the area and selling up for inflated prices, some making profits of over 30%. To prevent this sort of practice, and also to preserve the rural aspect of Bourneville, in 1900 Cadbury renounced all financial interest in the project and handed control over to the Bourneville Village Trust. The deed of foundation made it clear that he intended the undertaking to expand. Clauses aimed to promote the growth of a community, to carry out research into housing, to use surplus income for the extension and improvement of the estate. Above all, he wanted to improve the conditions of the labouring classes, not just in Birmingham, but elsewhere in Great Britain. It's through the efforts of the Village Trust that Bourneville has retained its special character, and the houses designed by Harvey and later architects look just as they did when built at the turn of this century. The Trust was not, however, without its critics, and Cadbury, its first chairman, was accused of setting too high a level of rents so as to be selective in his choice of tenants. As for those tenants, it was neither the intention nor the practice to restrict occupancy solely to employees of the chocolate factory. By 1919, not only had these almshouses been provided mainly, but again not exclusively, for Cadbury pensioners, but the infant mortality rate in Bourneville was down from 13 per thousand to 7 per thousand, nearly half that for the rest of the city. The Bourneville idea was followed in Birmingham soon afterwards by another less well-known example of planned housing development, the Harborne Tenants Limited Estate. Built by Joseph Nettlefold and consisting of some 500 houses, the estate prospered and was soon boasting similar results in the improved health of its residents as Bourneville. As partners in the enterprise, the tenants were in a way also the landlords, and so had a vested interest in the success of the estate. But it was pressure on land and the call for ever more houses that was to prevent any large-scale adoption of development along Bourneville lines elsewhere. And so while the Trust has moved with the times, the village retains its chocolate box image as the purest and most successful form of the garden suburb in England to this day. As the finishing touches were put to the village, to its famous carillon, to Ruskin Hall and the Friends Meeting House, its fame spread. People came from all over the world to view a unique experiment in modern living. When a New Street wine merchant sold a derelict printing works to Herbert Austin, he wasn't to know the deal would mark the beginnings of a company that would become famous around the world within 20 years. For it was here to Longbridge that Herbert Austin came in 1905 to lay the foundations of an empire. The move to Longbridge with a capital investment of £15,000 was a big step for the former sheep shearing machine engineer. His first Longbridge made vehicle was successfully displayed to the press in April 1906. In those days, the company employed 270 men, and one car was completed every 2 days. In 1910, the factory was turning out nearly 600 cars a year. It was found necessary to start a night shift. By the outbreak of the First World War, Austin was employing 2,000 men, and production of vehicles had risen to 30 a week. These were good times, not just for Austin, but also for Birmingham's gunmakers at the BSA factory in Small Heath. Their first safety bicycle was a success. They got hold of Dunlop's pneumatic tyre, and in the slack periods when demand for armaments was low, they were quick to adapt production and take advantage of the bicycle boom of the 1890s. But it was the motor industry and its allied trades which made the greatest headway in the first two decades of the 20th century. Production was often a hit-and-miss affair. Powered tools were few and far between, and only the larger factories had lifting gear. Most cars were made by teams of men, and the production line was an idea still in the head of Henry Ford. The railway companies hadn't been slow to meet the challenge of the internal combustion engine. The opening years of the century saw complementary building schemes at both of Birmingham's mainline stations, Snow Hill and New Street. More of Birmingham's city centre slumland had been demolished to accommodate New Street's Midland Railway extension in 1885. When these photographs were taken in the new station 20 years later, the rival Great Western Railway was transforming the fabric and running lines of Snow Hill, as well as engineering a short cut on the route to the capital. The London and North Western Railway had introduced a two-hour service to London in 1905, and 5 years later both companies were in direct competition. This was the railway's greatest period, and the long, hot summer of 1914 saw all records broken for excursion and holiday traffic. But they were also troubled times. There were other events vying for attention.
Millions rallied to the flag, irrespective of political distinction. On the recruiting records of 1914 will reveal the fact that conservatives, liberals and socialists were equally moved by the same paramount impulse of affection for their native land and its honor.
While Birmingham men formed themselves into PALS battalions and went to France to be killed in their hundreds, their women went into action to meet the call for arms. The output was prodigious. Between May 1915 and the end of hostilities, 15 million shells had been produced in the Birmingham area. Laid end to end, they would have stretched for 3,000 miles. Cycle companies were quick to convert back to armaments, and BSA went on to 24-hour shifts 7 days a week. Their motorcycle workshops were soon at full stretch, making hundreds of sturdy Beezer machines, not only for the Royal Signals in Flanders and France, but also for the Russian and Belgian armies, and even the South African Motorcycle Corps in German East Africa. But there can be no doubt that the company's biggest single contribution was the Lewis gun. BSA supplied all the Lewis guns for British forces. They came off the production line at the rate of 2,000 a week, compared to 50 in peacetime. The outbreak of war came almost too soon for the infant Austin Company. The government contracts tended to go to established firms. But Austin was soon making military vehicles, and to do so increased the labour force from 280 to a wartime peak of 20,000, many of them women. As well as machine guns, ambulances, shells and fuses, the Longbridge factory produced over 350 aeroplanes. Wolseley Motors made aero engines and Lucas the magnetos. To test fly the planes, a patch of land was levelled at the back of the factory, creating a circular landing strip. Birmingham was thus a logical target for German air raids, and on one of three occasions when Zeppelins got through to the Midlands, Longbridge was bombed and two people were injured. The number of factories that continued to be diverted to war purposes was astonishing, and it was equally remarkable how the range of products was broadened. The famous Mills hand grenade was invented in Birmingham, and works which normally turned out railway carriages and tramway rolling stock were converted to production of tanks, shells and guns. On Win the War Day, September the 21st, 1918, a procession 2 miles long passing through the city was a rare demonstration of what was being done on the home front to bring victory and to stimulate further efforts to do so. The toll in human lives should have been effort enough, and the city's roll of honour, enshrined in the Hall of Memory, lists over 11,000 Birmingham men who didn't come back from the war.
During the 4 years of conflict, the common aim had brought a halt in house building, a holding action in public transport, a truce in labour relations, but an advance in workers' aspirations. In particular, the need to provide homes fit for heroes had become a national issue.
There were other national issues. A rail strike in 1919 revealed deep-seated grievances on the part of the railwaymen. And in 1926, the attempt to make savings on the miners' wage bill of 30 shillings a week was the last straw to a labour movement that had steadily grown in strength and confidence during the war years.
In the general strike in Birmingham in 1926, the performance of the workers was really quite noble, though on the whole most of them had very little in the way of vested interest in the strike. On the whole, they were coming out simply to support the miners. And despite the fact that Birmingham wasn't an area of great trade union strength, the workers were pretty solid in support of the General Council of the TUC and in support of the miners. However, the strike was broken on the roads, as in most of the country. I'm ashamed to say that the students of the University of Birmingham disgraced themselves in trade union eyes by running the Selly Oak bus depot during the strike. And whereas the railway workers and so on remained absolutely solidly out throughout, that wasn't so of the road transport workers, bus drivers, tram drivers.
During the general strike, Austin production continued almost at full strength, largely thanks to this car, the famous Baby Austin 7. It was designed in 6 months in 1922 by Herbert Austin, working at home with the draftsman Stanley Edge.
Promoted as the mighty miniature, the Baby Austin cost £168. An object of ridicule because of its diminutive size, less than 9 feet long. Its turning point in sales came when the papers reported that a Cambridge undergraduate had ordered one, providing instant snob appeal. At a time when part of his factory was in the hands of the receiver, it was a personal triumph for Herbert Austin.
He didn't like the idea of a motorcycle and combination and everybody out in the wet. And he had this idea for a light car, but the directors were against it. They favoured the 14, 16 and 20 horse, which a lot of people did in those days. And funny enough, he announced his intention to build this light car, of all places, at the Motorcycle and Combination Sight Car Dinner in Birmingham, to say, virtually, I'm going to put you out of business, I'm going to provide a vehicle which will take two adults and two children in the dry.
Thank you.
realize, I hope, that in buying British, you encourage progress. That by encouraging progress, you restore prosperity. I know well enough that even when you buy a product which is British, as a family chancellor, you can take no risk.
How's this for a sponsor's message? Herbert Austin filmed for a cinema advertisement in 1932.
I trust, however, that when next you buy a car, you will find it easy to decide which car you will buy. Having seen for yourselves how British cars are made and how motoring dependability is assured, your Austin dealer awaits your call. He can equip you with means of enjoying the heritage of every Britisher, your heritage. A country unexcelled in beauty and a road system of unrivaled excellence.
All modes of transport are in readiness. 60 trams, 120 coaches, 5 trains, over 300 motorcycles, 700 automobiles, over 2,000 bicycles. From every gate the human flood pours out. More trams, more trains, more buses. And still there are more to come, by road, by rail, on foot. The day's work is forgotten. But 400 automobiles have been built in the Austin factory and are on their way to new owners who, it is hoped, will give a thought to the skill, initiative and power, to the natural resources of the British Empire that have provided them with this intricate machine that has become a necessity in a modern age.
In 1932, quite a few Brummies were getting to work in or on their own transport, but the majority by far travelled by tram. Birmingham's tramway story had begun with a horse-drawn vehicle along the Bristol Road in 1872. It was followed with an experiment in cable-drawn trams from Snow Hill to the Jewellery Quarter, and an ill-fated excursion into battery power that threatened to poison the passengers with acid fumes. Then came the steam tram, looking more like a public convenience than a conveyance. Not until the first electric tram did they find the formula for success.
I think that as a member of the public, you have a stake in them, you can ride on them, and you're very close to the driver. You could watch him driving, whereas on a steam locomotive, unless you are very lucky, you don't ride on the footplate. But you're very close to being in charge, really.
Trams always had a reputation for lowering the tone of a place, you see. This was the thing. It was looked on as the artisan's means of transport from A to B, you know, and people in Edgbaston had their own horse carriages and such like, and some even sported motor cars in those early days. But they didn't want trams along the Hagley Road.
We used to lug the numbers, and we found there was the 1 to 20 class, the 21 to 70 class, 71 to 220 class, and so on and so on. Find out if there was a new class. And of course, if ever a permanent way car came on the scene, which of course was a very funny low number, we used to wonder what on earth PW1 was and PW9.
If any car was in trouble, any accident or collision, it was always car 608. Number 608 was the Jinx car. 611 was reckoned to be just that bit faster than all the others. We had one driver on the Oxhill Road route back in the 20s and 30s, and he could make any car go faster than the others, and one of his favourite tricks was to put the chain across and ride on the chain as the car was belting along.
It's ironic in a city charged with stabbing itself to death with roads that the tram should have survived for over 60 years. Certainly before the age of the motor car, it was the tram and the bicycle that let the working man live further from his place of work. And the rapidly spreading tentacles of the tram lines, and to a lesser extent the bus routes, fueled the increasing demands for a greater Birmingham.
As the city expanded, people were encouraged to move into the outer circle of suburbs.
It was the demand for more and more housing that was to be the council's major objective in the 1930s.
Birmingham acquired an awful lot of new suburbs in 1909. The size of the city was tripled overnight by acquiring places like Harbourne and Quinton and so on. And a lot of new development was carried out by the municipality during the 20s and 30s. Sometimes very big-scale developments like Wheely Castle and King Standing, both in the 1930s, which are, I suppose, architecturally kind of debased garden suburb sort of areas. There were also some very interesting inner-city developments like the flats and maisonettes at Emily Street in Highgate, recently demolished, like the very interesting Dutch Queen Anne flats at Garrison Lane in Small Heath, which are still there, and I hope they have a future life ahead of them. But most of it was suburban and built on a very big scale in the 20s and 30s.
In the 20 years between 1919 and 1939, the corporation were to build over 50,000 houses, a figure only slightly less than that achieved by private builders in the same period. By 1926 and before the Depression of 1931, Birmingham Council were showing the whole of England the lead. In the peak year of 1930, it had completed no fewer than 6,715 houses on the Wheely Castle and King Standing estates. House number 30,000 was opened in King Standing by the Health Minister in 1930, number 40,000 by Neville Chamberlain in Wheely Castle in October 1933, and number 50,000 in Stechford 6 years later in 1939. It was an achievement never to be matched. On a different scale, with Birmingham at the centre of the railway Iron Cross, London was getting ever nearer. The two-hour barrier was broken by an LMS express in 1935, and the battle between the two railway companies for supremacy over the route could only benefit the customer.
The majority of families didn't have cars. You were very lucky if you had a car. And you went to school by train if you were lucky, and you went on your holidays by train. There were all these wakes weeks that they used to have in the north, and the holidays such as we had here, the factory holidays in Birmingham. You had sidings and sidings of empty stock which were kept specially for all these excursions. But the local trains, of course, in those days were very busy too. I know they are now, but this is almost a resurgence, a minor resurgence, of what used to happen up until the 30s when people started to get a bit more mobile.
Birmingham was also agitating for its own airport, since Claude Graham White had flown into Bourneville before the existence of a more conventional airstrip at Castle Bromwich. Here in the summer of 1938, RAF Hawker Hines performed for the Empire Day crowds, but behind all the frivolity once again loomed the spectre of war.
Provision has to be made for the protection of persons and property in the event of hostile air attack. This is a new section of national defence and is purely civilian. As a munitions centre, Birmingham is a special area, and there is every likelihood that if war broke out, it would be one of the first parts of the country to be attacked.
If you would like to enter the competition which accompanies the series, details of how to obtain this free booklet and entry form can be had from any of these places in the Birmingham area. As you can see, that includes Pebble Mill Reception and branches of Barclays Bank.